Hello everyone. I'm Eric Leblanc. I'm, as you can guess, French. And I'm one of the NetFilter developers, but I'm here for my, one of my other big job, which is to work on Suricata, which is an IDS, so an intrusion detection system. I'm not a kernel developer, so be unsure that there is no kernel ARM during the making of this talk. Just use the tools, and I just want to show you how I've been using the new tool, which are eBPF and XDP, to provide some nice feature into Suricata. So, yes, what is Suricata? Suricata is an IDS and IPS engine, which means intrusion detection system and intrusion prevention system. It's open source and it's owned by a foundation, which is quite interesting in terms of perennity of a project. So what it's doing? It's taking the packet from the network and is doing a protocol analysis of what it's seeing. So basically it's using the main usage we have is using IF packet to sniff the traffic, then we get the raw packet, and we are doing the analysis so we can get to the application layer and get all information about that. So in fact, we are doing exactly what is doing the internal network stack of Linux, but we are doing our own separately because we want to analyze things for one complete network and not just for the box. So we cannot rely on what is done on the Linux stack. So I could spend a few hours on this graph, so I will just jump to this, the next slide, so you can see what Suricata is in fact doing. So Suricata is there, it's just this small part that is taking the data, taking some rules, which is in kind of policy of what is known to be bad, and that using that, it does generate a file or push data outside that can be used later by some other people to analyze the risk on the network and to also know what is going on the network. So the job that Suricata is doing is the following. Is from the network stack or from the capture method is getting all the packet, IP packet, one by one. Then it's doing a series of checks, reconstructing the TCP packet, for instance, by defragmenting. Then once we have a TCP packet, we will provide a stream. We will do the streaming part that will allow the analysis on this, because we want to do this analysis on this stream, because this stream is what the application see. For instance, if you have, you want to, you have want to detect an attack on download because it's bad on your website. If down is put on the first packet and load is put on the second packet, if you make the analysis on the TCP, you've got a super easy evasion, so you won't see the string that we are looking for. But by providing the stream, then in that case you have everything is reconstructed, is seen as it's seen on the TCP where you just do read and write. So by doing this, you get the information. And then we've got, for some application layer, we've got normalization, so we can access to subfield inside of the protocol. And the interesting thing is that we want to do that for a enterprise network. So we're talking currently about 10 gigabytes per second, and in some cases it's 100 gigabytes per second. But the normal usage is around 10 gigabytes per second currently. So what is produced by Suricata is this kind of event in JSON, where you can get all the IP information, detail about an alert. And as you can see in this example, we are even able to extract some information from the protocol. Here we got one key, which is the email. And all this kind of data is put in a database system or a cluster of Elasticsearch or Splunk, something like that. Then you can do some dashboard. Okay, so yeah, let's get back to the main target of this goal of this talk. So Suricata is using IFPacket, which is the raw socket system, and we are using the memory mapped version. We are also using the fan out, which had been introduced in 4.1, if I remember, no, 3.16, I think, something like, which allow Suricata to get a multiple thread reading one single interface. Because if you just have one thread that can read the traffic on one interface, you cannot really do correct load balancing, so it does not scale really well. We can scale in software, but the sooner we start to load balance, the better it is. So the most used threads system in Suricata is what we call the worker mode, which is basically doing all the tasks that I've described you before in the reconstruction schema, and is using that by doing load balancing on the Ethernet card, then splitting, going to one CPU, and one CPU is doing all the treatment in one chain of tasks that are kept on one thread. So we've got some issues that sometimes occur. For instance, we are heavily dependent on the hash function on the interface to be symmetric, because if we are not doing that, if you took that case, we've got two threads with two flow, and the one we are interested is this one. And if we are doing the treatment with one side of the flow going to one thread and the other side going to another thread, then in that case, the result could be what we see an answer before we see the initial message. So we get out of order, and by getting out of order, we cannot do easily the analysis inside Suricata because we don't have the correct order of packet. So everything was fine, and then in 4.2, to fix a few things that occur in this company, Sommerberg did introduce, did break the hash that was used by IFPacket. So we did have users that start to complain, it's not working as good as it was working before, because the effect is quite interesting, is that it's still not dropping packet, but the accuracy of the detection is going down because we are not able to reconstruct the flow. So you just have less event coming, and you're in a total mess, and it's not working. So the fix was pushed to stable by David Miller in 4.6. Yes, and we also have some issues, like if you take the XL 510 or 710, in the XL 510, the hash is not symmetrical by default, so we cannot relay on the load balancing made by the cart using the RSS mechanism. And on the XL 700, it could be symmetrical, but it has not been implemented in the driver, so we need to use a patch driver for now, and I will try to get back the work by Victor Julien to push that upstream, because the initial push was rejected. So yeah, why eBPF? eBPF can be used on IFPacket to set up the load balancing function. So we can have we can attach an eBPF program to one socket, and then do the load balancing by issuing by returning an integer. That will be used to know on which socket, because we can attach multiple sockets to one network interface, so we got multi-threading for reading the packet from the socket, and by using the eBPF cluster, we can have an eBPF program file that is saying, that is setting which socket will receive the packet by parsing the packet. So one standard, one classical thing that I wanted to do is to be able to have an IP pair load balancing. So this way, the conversation between two hosts are staying on the same thread, and so reach the same socket. And it's quite easy to do because we just have to pass the IP layer. So what is doing, what we are doing with eBPF is that we will just declare a function which is load balancer that will be loaded by Suricata, and then it will be attached to the socket. So the bad thing with eBPF seen from the network is that you don't have all that Brendan didn't show today, which is easy access to things. You need to parse yourself the packet to be able to extract the information you want. So it's a bit more complicated from just accessing parse packet. So you need to do the parsing yourself. But in this case, it's quite easy. You just load word, then you get the IP address, and then stupid hash just to test adding source and DST to get something which is symmetrical. The interest of eBPF could be really high because in some network you got almost all the traffic that is that can be seen that pass through one session. For instance, you can have L2TP or GTP, and in this case it's a tunnel that encapsulates almost all the traffic and that can be easily de-encapsulated. And the problem is that as it is a big flow, it can overrun things, so it's better to split it before. This could be done by using eBPF cluster. So I was started to talk about big flow. This is a real problem for Suricata. One thread of Suricata can just handle something like 500 to 1 gig of traffic. So if you got one flow that is taking more than 1 gig per second, then in that case, you will start to lose packet because the thread, it will accumulate on the thread. If we took at this, if you got a fair load balancing, then in that case, it's easy. It gets directly to the threads. But if you got unfair load balancing, then in that case, you can saturate a bit. But if you got a really big flow, then you will just fill in, and you will not see. You will lose some packet, and you can even lose packet from an overflow. So you just have not only an impact on the flow, but you will have an impact on all the flow that should have reached this thread. So you can try as Hive Packet is using a ring buffer. You can try to increase the ring buffer, but the only thing that you will be able to fix with that is some really bursty flow, because if you stay at with one big flow that's like a backup that will stay there for 1 hour, it will be better for 1 hour. For 1 hour, you've got your network which is completely down in terms of analysis because of that. So a common method to avoid this kind of thing is to say, okay, if I see a big flow, I know it's a big flow because it's big. So I can just have a counter and decide to bypass this flow. So just say, okay, I don't want to see it anymore. So there is one easy bypass method, which is that when the packet reaches Suricata, we can say, okay, I know this is part of a big flow, so I just do a basic decoding, no complex handling, and then I say, let's bypass. So that's the local bypass. And there is also a second method that I've developed, which is the capture bypass, which in this case you say, oh, I'm able to say to the capture method that I don't want to see this flow anymore. So you take that decision, you send that decision to the capture method, and then it handles the bypass itself. So what we are doing, this is the soft bypass. So if we do a bypass in kernel, we just have the packet, we drop the packet, so we managed to reduce the load on the system. Um, One thing which is really often used in the IDS world is the fact that most attacks occur at the start of a flow. So you get 99% of the thing if you just analyze the start of a flow, so with a size that you can set. So this size is called the stream depth. So what we are doing in Suricata is that we can now say, I want to bypass a flow after the stream depth. So the stream depth is when we reach the stream depth, we've seen, for instance, 1 megabyte of the flow, then we can say, OK, I want to bypass it. So in this case, we do the bypass. We can also, not meant to burn down, but we can also bypass Netflix. So for that, we could do one signature that will analyze the traffic of Netflix and then see that it's Netflix or just by. And then we can have one specific bypass. We don't want to see movies that can be done, so we lower the load on the IDS. So on Suricata, the implementation was quite simple. It's just a callback function, what we call when we want to bypass. But on the main work is done on the capture method that needs to handle that and need to provide this method. So the first one on lazy one was the NFQ bypass, so the net filter queuing for the IPS mode. For this one, it was really simple because it was just setting a mark, and then you have to tune your IP tables rule set or NF tables rule set to reject all the packet with that mark. To not send the packet, not to reject, but to not send the packet to Suricata if there is a mark. So this was done, and then wanted to do the same on IF packet. So this means that Suricata need to be able to tell the kernel that he wants to ignore some flow. So we need to have a kind of list of flow that we need to maintain in the kernel. We have to be able to update this from user space, and the kernel should be able to not send the packet if it sees that a packet belongs to the flow. So if we try to do that with NF tables, it does not work, even in ingress, because the capture method IF packet is before the NF table, net filter hook. So the not easy solution, but the only remaining solution was eBPF, that has a system which is called maps. So basically, it's kind of it's a hash that we can have. You got maps, and one of the type of maps that is interesting in your case is an array or a hash, and it can be updated and fetched from user space. So that was looking good. To interact with BPF, you've got BCC that Brendan didn't talk about, but it does not work in my case because it's relay on building things outside of a tree, outside of a software, so it was not correct for me. In the case of Suricata, I just need to be able to load a BPF file and then update the object. So one good candidate that seems to, where people seem to aggregate, is currently libbpf that can be found in tools lib bpf inside the Linux tree. So it was a bit stopped because everybody was playing with some C file, exchanging some C file instead of using a library. So that was a bit bad, but now people tend to use libbpf and it's almost usable now. You just need to copy the header file to make install is working, but you need to copy the header file by hand. So it's, I think some patches are coming. The usage is quite simple. You take, you get the path to the BPF file you want to load, and you just open the file. And then if you want to iterate on the information, you can do an iteration of a map and get information like that. So what I've done for the on the kernel side, so the eBPF filter, is that I introduce a map of type hash, which has a key size, which is my flow v4 keys. So basically, it's the IP tuple. And it stores some data, so I want to keep the time. Last time I've seen a packet on this flow, and I want to have some counter of packets on bytes on the half flow. I'm working with by half flow, that's why I've just got no direction in that counter. And what is doing the filter is basically that. I've got a parsing that I have to done in my BPF filter, and then I do a lookup on the flow table. And if I found the element, then I return zero, which means a drop in eBPF filter. And if it's not in the hash table, then in that case, I return minus one to get the packet sent to the lower, to the capture socket. So the good thing here is that the data is even updated with stats, so I got an idea of what's going on the system, and I can even get the last flow activity, so I can time out myself from Suricata. I will not have a ghost entry because I put something and I don't know when it's finished. I can still use a timeout mechanism to remove the entry from Suricata by getting the information. So in user space code, I'm doing that. I'm iterating on all the entry in the map, and I'm checking the timeout. If the timeout conversion to second is superior to the bypass flow timeout, then in that case, I can just delete the element from the hash in the kernel with this call, and then I switch to my next case. So I've made some tests with a server running on live traffic. So the good thing is that it's real traffic, so it's really significant compared to what we can have. But the bad thing is that it's real traffic, so you cannot reproduce between the runs. So you need to make a middle and make multiple runs to see how it is going. So I've made 1 hour long run with a different stream depth value to know when I start to bypass, and I've collected the Suricata stats and used TimeLion to make the graphing. Information. You got one peak which is interesting here, which is the instant bypass percentage. We see that we got some peak at the moment. We got some kind of big flow coming, and you've got a bypass that is occurring. So instead of getting a big amount of data, we just have bypass that did show that did work correctly. And this one is even more interesting. You go see the number of captured packets that is just getting almost null, because we just had at this moment one single big flow on the system, and by bypassing it, we managed to have almost no packet captured. No packet captured and no packet handled by Suricata. So that was just what I was saying. So you're cool with the bypass. It allows you to really stop receiving packet and lower the load on the system. Then there is still one problem is that we all by using this we already have a lot of things that I've done inside the kernel, because we Hive packet is accessing each packet is creating the SKB and making a lot of handling for that, so it has a cost. So to avoid this kind of cost, the Xtreme data path for XDP project has been started by the network people last year, And the idea of XDP is to be able to access to the packet before we create the SKB. So what we have is that we got a raw packet page inside the driver, so we access the data that the network card has directly by getting a pointer on the start of data and a pointer of the end of data. And then we can do almost anything. We can modify the packet. We can decide to pass, which is in fact send it to the network stack. And we can decide to drop, which will be in fact a really, really early drop that will drop the packet just after the network card got it. We can also bounce the traffic. So it seems it can be useful for some load balancing case. So you got packet coming on the interface and you get it with some, you modify it a bit and then you send it back to the same network interface. And something that looks really promising, at least for me, it's the XDP redirect, which is you can define a map that link some parameters with some interface. So you can have your eBPF filter that says that do the routing directly on this buffer. So for instance, what we will what I may use it in the future for Suricata is to be able to do IPS. So basically, you've got one interface. And on the second one, you pair them. And each time you see a packet on one interface, you send it to the second. And in that case, we could implement the bypass by just instead of saying, I want to drop or pass the packet, you send the redirect message, and then the packet get directly transferred to the second network card. So that should be really, really super fast. If you want to know more about XDP, I recommend you two good presentations by Jesper Dongard Brewer, which is working on the subject. So what kind of performance do we have? I was not able to do the test, so I'm taking some results that I found or in Jesper presentation or in the kernel commit log. So we can have two drop packets. We can, on one single CPU, we can drop 28 million of packets per second, which is really huge. And if you do some modification on sending back, you can reach 10 million of packets per second on one single CPU, which is really, really impressive. As we get the packet really early, we need modified driver to be able to access this system. So we currently have a list of drivers that support that feature. And in the kernel 4.12, we got a generic driver which has been introduced. So you can now use a kind of fake, which is really nice to be able to develop things. Mode where you get the packet like it is XDP, but after the SKB has been built. So you don't have a performance, but you have a feature. So I did work on implementing XDP bypass in Suricata. So there is some issue on that. The first one is that I don't have any more access to the SKB, so there is even more parsing that we need to do. And another point is that there is currently no support for XDP in libBPF. So I think I will submit a patch to do it, basically taking a function which is defined somewhere else and introduce it in libBPF. And one thing which is that I did not yet manage to do is that if you want to be really efficient, XDP is thought to have per CPU structure, like a hash per CPU, an array per CPU. So the fastest way to handle a high rate of packet will be to have this structure which is per CPU, but this means that or you, in my case, that or you duplicate or you find a clever way to interact with the load balancing to be able to know that your packets are coming and will be for sure in the hash if they have to be in the hash. There is also the possibility to do the capture with to implement XDP capture method. So this will be by using perf event. So perf event is providing a memory map ring buffer that you can share with a user space. The idea will be to put the packet with some information in the ring buffer and then read that from the user space. So we will have the possibility to just say I want to drop the packet in terms of XDP, but before we will do a copy in a user space shared ring buffer, so we'll be able to read that from the user space, so from Suricata. There is some complexity in that, is the same things about the CPU. The ring buffer is per CPU, so this means we need to really pin well the CPU on the thread that will handle the packet to be able to access to all the ring buffer that are per CPU. So there is some complexity in there. But it's we can already pin CPU in Suricata, so that will be just some setup that will be a little bit tricky, but there's nothing impossible there. So I've got a working implementation of XDP bypass, no work yet done for XDP capture. So as you can see on these slides, you need to do the parsing by yourself, so that's a bit of pain. To redo that, so yes, you get the packet, you get the Ethernet protocol, then you can remove the VLAN header if you have some VLAN header. Yeah, that's quite painful. It would be nice if people started to provide some kind of, not a library maybe for decoding packet, but at least some macro or something to be able to access. But it's really new, so I think that maybe people will get to that in the future. So as a conclusion, it's a bit fresh. There is be ready to copy some header file, be ready to hack your own function because it's not working. But it's quite promising. The bypass using eBPF was already really efficient. I really want to test in the next weeks the bypass by using XDP on some devices. If you want to get a look at the code, you can find it on GitHub. And I pushed my crappy patch to be able to use libbpf with XDP. I need to add the error handling because currently I just commented printf function. So I'm standing between you and the lunch, literally. So if you have questions.
I have one question back here. Do you have any idea about latency that it adds? Can you use Suricata on latency-sensitive applications?
Usually, Suricata is getting a duplicate of the traffic, You do not put it on the packet path for your network.
Okay.
But we've got an IPS mod, and in IPS, for sure, there is latency. So if you've got a latency critical application, I will not recommend to use Suricata because it's just an horror. It's just a nightmare because you can have packets that go really fast. If you have, for instance, you get in the bypass mode, you have almost no impact. But in some cases, as we are going really far in the protocol decomposition, we can, for instance, on HTTP, I did not mention that, but we are de-zipping the page to get into the content of the HTTP body. And then we are doing, in some cases, some complex regular expression, even Lua scripting on it. on the content. So you can see that you can have for one packet that will be a few microseconds to one packet that will be not 1 second, but almost. So it's really few packets, but for the latency, it's just a nightmare.
Okay, thanks.
In fact, it's not only the processing which delays delivery of the packets, but since you are processing incoming data and analyzing contents, you are subject to multiple RTTs between the client and the place where Suricata is located. So I guess that in many environments, in fact, you will spend more time waiting for the packets from the client than processing them.
Nope.
If you have, for example, 100 millisecond RTT between the client and the place where Suricata is implemented, and you need to process some data which are far, as you said, for example, because you need to decompress or whatever, maybe you will have to wait for 30 or 40 kilobytes of data. And it will require that you have multiple round trips for the TCP congestion window to increase. And so it will cause multiple RTTs between the client and the IPS, just so that the window increases and the client is allowed to push the data.
Yeah, but we've got an analysis which is done as soon as we got a data packet. We work on the data packet and we still send the packet. We are not waiting for the completion of the data segment.
Okay.
So.
But I meant if you have to consider some far away data to take a decision. That's what I meant.
Yeah. But usually we have got a copy of a buffer. Mm. We're making a stream reassembly. Mm. So we keep the stream reassembly and we can let the packet go.
Okay.
And we cut, we only block the packet in IPS mode. Only when we see the bad data. So we got the bad data, it will be blocked. And this one can take long. But we do not wait to send the other one.
Okay.
Behind.
Normally, when an incoming packet arrives on NIC, there is an indirection table and a hash provided in the NIC. So is it the driver that implements the hashing function that afterwards goes in the indirection table, or is it the driver?
It's the driver, I think, that is making the driver or the card. The network card is putting the hash in most cases.
Okay, so you can modify it. But if I want to generate multiple new packets, knowing the hash function, I can make sure that all the packets going to the same CPU and the same interrupt line, and so I can submerge the only single thread that will process the packets.
Yeah, sure. If you know the function, for sure you can do that. Yeah, but it's easy to just do one big flow. you can have multiple flow with the technique. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, because you said that you were just looking at the first incoming connection. First packet, not the rest of the flow.
Yeah.
In fact, you have the same problem even with many network equipment, some switches, backplanes, or whatever. Sometimes just using too few source and destination IP addresses, or maybe using just a single source MAC address results in the same thing. They are all angry.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Bon appétit.